I was at a meeting of the other audio club, the Golden Ear Group, and as usual, I started pontificating about the necessity of linear tracking for a turntable. If anyone hasn't seen Ray Kilmanas' AES paper on the physics of tone arms, you must read it. An offset arm generates frequency modulation at the tone arm resonant frequency due to its geometry. There's a YouTube video we found that demonstrates how bad it can be if you take a high compliance cartridge and put it in too massive a tone arm. You can actually hear the warbles from it. It's that bad. The host of that meeting had this Mitsubishi LT-20 that wasn't working, and I was looking at it, and he said, "It doesn't work. Maybe you want to take it and see if you can do something with it." Of course, I took it. He even had the original bill of sale from the gramophone dated April 1st, 1982 for $359.95. And the problem was is the arm won't advance. The cueing mechanisms were working, but when it went down on the record, it stopped moving forward. It would move backwards, but that doesn't do any good unless you have a record that plays from the inside out. I got lucky and I found a service manual on the Vinyl Engine website. And this is a picture of the turntable. It's not a high-end piece of equipment, not a low-end piece. Nice, neat design. It's a direct drive turntable with the linear tracking arm. It's got some interesting features. If you look at the top left, there's a little post sticking up there next to the 45 RPM adapter. That thing's a light source. And those nibs you see on the mat are actually prisms. As the thing rotates, there's phototransistors underneath that peak at the light source, and it's able to tell whether you've got a 7-inch disc, which it assumes is a 45, or a 12-inch disc, it assumes 33 and a third. If there's no disc, it won't let you put the arm down on the mat and destroy your stylus, which is nice thinking. I appreciate that. The controls are fairly straightforward. Stop, start, and a cue button. When the cue is up, the stop and start are your forward and reverse motion. It's got an auto repeat function and a speed override, which is nice because there's a lot of audiophile records that are 12-inch LPs recorded at 45, and this is able to play them. This is the arm mechanism. It's a fairly conventional arm, counterweighted. It has a slider weight on the shaft and calibrated for setting your tracking force after you balance it. The arm rides on a trolley below, held by two posts that ride through the back slot. The front slot has a little plunger under the arm that you can't see in this photo, and there's a mechanism that uses that plunger to lift the arm up when you want to cue. This is the servo system below driving this arm. It uses similar parts for both the lift and the positioning motors, probably for ease of production. The trolley is on your left there. It's a little hard to see in this photo, but there's a brass rail here, and you can just barely see the two wheels that ride on that. They're notched wheels like a railroad wheel. And then there's one more wheel that rides on the front plate where you see that little galvanized platform that it rides on. So it's a three-wheel trolley. It's driven by a cord that you see wrapped around there. The motors are connected through a little belt for vibration isolation and then geared down with a worm gear. One drives the belt for the trolley. The second one drives the cam you see on the right there. That cam presses against this black plate you see that's hinged on the forward side. It's a little hard to see, but this plate has like a scoop along the other edge of it, and that's where that plunger rides. You'll be able to see it better in a future slide.
So that's for cueing?
That's for cueing. There's limit switches for end of travel, and one of the limit switches operates a set of relays for muting. The positioning is all done photoelectrically. If you look at this plate that runs along the top here, there's three slots in it. One slot is the down position for the 12-inch LP. The other one's for the 7-inch 45. The little slot at the end is your lead-out position. And since they're specified by a standard, they're all cut into this plate to adjust together. You can't see it in this shot, but that hole in the upper right has a spring on it that pulls the plate towards the left. If you look at the little E-ring there at the left, that's actually in a slot. You can't see it because it's black on black. And there's a screw that goes through the side of the base where you can adjust that to align everything. The rest position is done with a limit switch that isn't visible here. It's covered up by too much equipment. That's adjusted separately and uses just a simple micro switch that the carriage hits because you don't need that mechanical isolation when the arm's on the rest. Here's a little bit closer shot of that extension plate. What you're seeing is the light side. These are little grain of wheat lamps in there. There's another board underneath that plate with the photo transistors on there for sensing. And this little circuit board carries the signal wires. You see the solder points for that. The other wires coming up and around are from the tracking sensors. Here's a wiring diagram of the layout. Upper left is those three lamps for the arm positioning system. And I cut this off a little bit, but it's coming down to a plug on the main circuit board. Next to that is the tracking sensor system. And those wires also wind their way around and end up on another plug on the circuit board, so there's a way to isolate them. Pulling the plugs allowed me to put an ohm meter across them, and the lamps were consistently reading 24 ohms cold. Here's some close-ups of those particular sets of lamps. The parts list says the lamps are all identical, but the lamps inside the base of the arm for the tracking sensors are paralleled, and that also measured 24 ohms, which kind of explained, I thought, why the system is not advancing. Obviously, one of these lights is out. Of course, that's the most difficult thing to get to in this whole system.
Of course.
This is a diagram of how the tracking system works in there. There's a vane you see in the middle of this plastic block that attaches to the horizontal gimbal section of the tone arm base. And it's between these two light beams from the two lamps, and they're shining on photodiodes on the other side. When the vane is centered, it's covering about half of the beam on each side, so it balances. This is the actual system, what it looks like. The plastic block with the sensing system, unfortunately, the spring was disconnected. There's a spring at the bottom that goes to that post that you see empty there, which pulls it sideways. And there's a set screw in the base of the arm that can move this side to side. It swivels around the collar of the arm post. And that way, when the arm is straight, you can align this so it's centered over the sensors when the arm is straight. So that's one of the alignment points. And you can see the two slots. This is the arm base flipped over, and you can see the little plunger for the arm lift that rides in the front slot. This base section has a metal plate that covers it up for shielding, and here's it with it pulled out. You can see that little shutter that comes off of the arm mechanism and the set screw coming through that positions it. Here's the lamp side of that contraption, and you can see the brown gunk on there. I don't know what that is. I don't see any need for glue to hold it in place. Those lamps aren't moving anywhere once they're soldered in. It could have been paint to cover them up. Maybe they were worried about light leakage. I can't explain it. But the leads from these grain of wheat lamps are steel. And whatever that stuff is, it corroded them. The wires broke. I shot this with a macro lens. If you look real close, you can see the filaments intact. It's just that the wires broke off right at the glass line. There's no way to fix it. So I had the specs. They're 6-watt, 3-millimeter grain of wheat lamps, and I searched everywhere you could on the internet. Nobody has them. You can get 5-watt, you can get 7-watt, you can't get 6-watt. Well, somebody on eBay had a box of 200 of these suckers, 7-watters, and said they weren't accurate 7-watts. I figure out of 200 of them, I might find a couple that are close to 6-watts. Well, they sent it by carrier turtle. It took a good 2 months or so to show up. And I went through and I checked them with ohmmeters and I put it on a bench power supply to measure the wattage. Every one of them was 5 watts thereabouts. So I was going to put a series resistor to get it down where it should be. That idea isn't going to work. I figured maybe I can get a 3-millimeter LED in there and have something that's got better longevity, but none of the LEDs I could find had any specs on lumens. I had no idea what the lamp puts out. I ordered some for the heck of it. I ordered a few different colors because I didn't know what was important. I figured the dim bulb was kind of warm, so pick something that's red or yellow. Maybe that has more spectrum, might get more pickup on that. So I ordered them, tried them out, made some measurements, and they just didn't have enough light intensity. Gave up on that idea. So I went back to searching the internet, and I was searching to see what other people had done with this turntable. I found two things on there. First, I found that a lot of these have been fried by zero-stat guns, these light-sensitive diodes they use for the tracking are easily blown. They're no longer made. These are naked chip diodes, not in a package. And the only thing that, the only naked chip I could find was one too big and cost $57 each, and they have to be matched for this to work. So I figured, well, let's try something else before I give up on this. I kept searching and found, just by accident, under Mitsubishi, instead of looking for lamps, a pair of factory spec lamps for the turntable. So I ordered them, installed them, and figured, aha, this is the direct replacement. This should work. Put it in. Same problem. No performance. So I'm. These are what the diodes look like on here. I saw some photodiodes that came in 3-millimeter packages that you could shove into the hole there. I didn't know if that was going to work. So I wondered, do I have a bad diode or what? I started measuring it using a VOM. I got totally different readings on the two of them. Using a sensitive ohmmeter gave me similar non-matching readings. So are they really bad? Well, the alignment instructions said connect them in series with 100 microamp meter movements. They normally should put out from 8 to 12 microamps. I happen to have a pair of 200 microamp movements, which I thought might work. I bought them years ago for a project that I never completed. And I remembered putting them in a box, so I spent several weeks looking through every box in my basement. Never found them. I found another way to handle this, which I'll talk about, but a few weeks ago I was cleaning up the basement and there they were sitting on top of the shelf out in plain sight, and I had assumed they were in a box, so I never bothered to look there. But I think my solution worked out better. I figured I gotta understand how this circuit works, because is that resistance significant? I lit up the bulbs with a battery and put a voltmeter on there, and they were both creating signals, so they weren't totally dead. Are they off spec or what? This is the circuit. I wanted to figure out how they work. I was reading specs on every kind of photodiode I could find, and I noticed some of the spec sheets gave a short circuit current rating. And the short circuit current rating was a constant K times the illumination level. So it's very interesting. The current into a short circuit, operating these as a current source, is extremely linear to the illumination. The voltage curve looks like a battery discharge curve in reverse. It's extremely steep and somewhat flat once it reaches its rated voltage. So obviously they want to run this thing in the current mode. And if you look at this, it's across the input of an op amp with a negative feedback circuit. So if you know op amp theory, the feedback should be driving the negative input till it equals the positive input, which means they're operating in this virtual short circuit mode. The input impedance is virtually infinite on the op amp, so whatever current is produced is flowing through those feedback resistors. They measured about 97K, and 8 microamps through that gives me about 0.8 volts, which was something readable on my digital meter. So I decided I could do without the ammeters and look at that as a way of knowing what's going on in there. Here's the problem. This is the circuit board. It's on the bottom of the turntable. And where is the chip that we were just looking at? It's under that heat sink. No way to get a probe on it. And of course, I need to take readings while the thing is running, so this would mean I have to get in there and take measurements laying upside down while it's supported between a couple of chairs. And I'm going to try and do this myself. My solution was to install a terminal strip you see next to it, and I tack soldered the wires onto each end of that feedback resistor. So if I go back to the schematic here, I can now read the voltages across those two feedback resistors. Well, with the thing all assembled, I'm reading, I put alligator clip leads on those test pins, ran them out so I could put the bottom plate on loosely, flip it over, and actually run it. Now I can take all these readings off of this thing while it's running. And I'm reading correct current through this. It's in the ballpark where it should be. Now I know the thing is working. If you look at the center of the schematic, you see an in and out connection. That's where the cueing signals come in. The servo auto line there switches control back and forth between the linear tracking system and the cueing system. This system is sort of a balanced bridge arrangement. The motor is connected across the two channels there, and the imbalance of what the diodes are reading drives the arm in the appropriate direction, and it's a linear system, so when you hit the lead out grooves, it runs faster, it runs very slow when you're on the normal part of the record. It's a rather nice design here. Well, there were two possibilities. Something inside the chip is gone, or some other mystery problems here that I don't understand. I started looking at the voltages to ground for some reason, just curiosity. I was mainly looking at the output of that input stage op amp to see what kind of signals I was getting there, and they did not match, even though I was reading the same current through both of them, which didn't make sense to me. So I read the input voltage, just looking at everything to look at, and they didn't match. Well, I went back, and on the center pin of that terminal strip, I connected back to the common connection of the two plus inputs of the input stage, which are biased at half the supply. The side that was working, the reverse side, the outside, the plus and minus were equal. They were not equal on the inside. So that told me that that op amp stage is not working. Back to the internet search, and this time I got lucky. Somebody had some of these chips for sale, not cheap, and of course it was in Europe. Here we go again with the slow boat from China, or this time from Germany. Another long wait. I got the chip, dropped it in, and this time success. I now have an operating system here. The chip was somewhere around $30 with all the shipping costs. I was tempted to order an extra one just to have it, but I wanted to see if it would work first. So now I have a successful turntable, and I don't want to take the cartridge out of my Rabco system. I intend to restore that eventually too. I found another V15 for sale, inexpensive, and bought that just to get the cartridge body. I was interested in this replacement stylus made by a company in Japan called Jico. A lot of people pronounce it differently. I have a friend that speaks Japanese and says that's the correct way to pronounce it. It's a drop-in replacement for the Shure stylus, except instead of a beryllium cantilever, it's made out of ruby. And it had an enormous price on it. And then one day, I went back and looked at it, and it was on sale $300 off on it. It turned out it was a closeout, and I was very lucky to grab one because that sale was only on for a couple of days. I took a wild chance on it just out of curiosity because they talked about low tip mass with this ruby cantilever. And I know Shure said that was one of the important things for trackability. It turns out it doesn't track any better than the 40-year-old original stylus did. But it does sound completely different than the Shure stylus. I have a friend that fools around with CD4 records. He was into that way back when and wants to be able to play it again. A stock V15, unlike most cartridges, will actually decode CD4, which means it has plenty of response above 20 kilohertz, but it didn't do a great job. The GECO stylus decoded it better than the Audio-Technica cartridge specifically designed for CD4, which means their exotic-shaped diamond does a much better job of retrieving the high frequencies. I doubt very much that it has to do with why it sounds different. It's not a tonal balance thing. You notice on complex material, like mass voices, you can hear individual voices more distinctly. The Shure original hyper-elliptical sounds like there's a blur or haze to it in comparison. So that's become my go-to system for playing vinyl. If you want to see the effect Kilmanas was talking about, there's a YouTube video complaining about the GECO stylus having problems in tracking. And what it is he's got a high mass articulated tone arm. And what happens when it bounces over the warp in the record, that changes your tracking force, which changes your skating force, which creates a side thrust on the arm, which excites the horizontal resonant frequency, and the arm wobbling back and forth creates a scrubbing action from the offset of the arm, which frequency modulates the sound. And you can hear the warble on that YouTube video, which proves my point. The only way to play vinyl is with a linear tracking arm. Thank you.
Question.
Yes.
How much time and how many dollars?
How many dollars? I suppose I spent about $50.
Oh, that's not too bad.
Time, it was about a year and a half.
Full time, right?
Yeah.
No, it was, go think about it. What do I try next? Order something, wait forever. When it comes, can I remember what it was for?
So are you going to move downstairs and listen to this thing? Super
light. Yeah, I don't have a lot of seating room down there, so we might have to work in shifts, but...
Sell tickets.
But it'll be available for the rest of the evening for anyone who wants to play vinyl.
When you're playing your vinyl, do you normally, at that point, make a backup copy on digital?
Yes.
Okay.
It goes right into my Tascam at 9624 and eventually gets normalized, edited, de-clicked, and ends up on a CD.
And then you play that from there on, probably?
Yeah.
Okay.
I am not a golden ear. I can't hear enough difference that it's worth the effort, and I don't want to wear out these one-of-a-kind direct disc recordings. I used to collect a lot of them. I bought every one I could find, and I had a friend who gave me a bunch more that I missed. So I want to play this stuff, at least have a way to get it onto digital.
Thanks, Dennis.
Very good. Thank you.
That's great.
In the 50s is recently for me.
Yeah. That's when they pulled out of race.
Yeah, they started to say, look, we really got to keep these cars away from the audience.
bad after just sitting around. Like there's a little,
there's like rubber
donut or something.
Right there, yeah, the compliance.
So Dennis, you had a TTS 3008. Is that what that is?
That can go on you.
Sony Turntable?
Depending on, you know, if you were.
Yeah, I just sold mine a couple of years ago. That's wild. But you put a Rapco on it.
You know, that could break it down.
Yeah.
Okay, let's say no.
That's actually one of my classes.
Yeah, because I still have.
You got a Fender center channel.
Let's try some different material. So I lost most of my audience.
I got that record.
This program has been a production of the Southeastern Michigan Woofer and Tweeter Marching Society. Opinions expressed during this program are those of the individual speaking and not necessarily the opinion of the Southeastern Michigan Woofer and Tweeter Marching Society.